Welcome everyone to the Religious Learning Program. Today we have with us once again Jonathan Burke. So now we'll switch over to our next topic, which I'm pretty excited about because I had there for a while. I thought I was the only one in our community that subscribed to Christian anarchism. I just want to give a little bit of background about myself and how I arrived to subscribing to those beliefs, and then I'll turn it over to Jonathan. For me personally, our community, Jonathan's in my community, already kind of had lays down the foundation of non-participation in politics, takes a non-violence stance on military, including police officers, things like that. I always struggled with these personally, didn't quite make sense until what helped me was I studied to become a certified public accountant, also studied economics to become an investor, as well as I'm an attorney. So I started looking at this and kind of realized that the Christadelphians may be onto something just from a moral standpoint. And I started following some economists that were anarchists, such as Robert Murphy, who takes kind of a Rothbardian view, who is also very religious. Bob Murphy's known for his Christian beliefs. And so I started reading a little bit more about anarchism in the Christian community. And that's when I came across Tolstoy, who at least made me more comfortable about this. One of the things I had struggled with was Romans 13, which Jonathan will get into. But I think I've found a way to understand Romans 13 that still allows for Christian anarchism. And that's kind of the trajectory. Our community laid the foundation with its doctrinal stances and then me understanding the laws of economics and the law as well. Finally made me realize that this religious stance makes so much more sense once you kind of see you bring the receipts, right? There's definitely evidence that nonviolence tends to move society and culture a lot further. And some of the ones I point out would be Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and they all, in fact, Gandhi went to, I believe, South Africa and lived in the Tolstoy commune of like a Christian anarchism before he went back to India and started the movement to peacefully break away from the UK. And of course, Martin Luther King brought civil rights to the oppressed minorities. And they did this kind of through this nonviolence. So to me, that brought some evidence that this Christian anarchism is subversive and works very, very well. Jonah, how did you arrive at your current stance of Christian anarchism?
From my point of view, of course, as you mentioned, the Christadelphian community has always had an extremely strong stance on its rejection of the state and the belief that believers should not become entangled in the state or indeed subjected to it personally as a servant of the state, that is, joining the government in any capacity, either in the judiciary or the executive or in the legislature. So, of course, in our standard statements of faith and accompanying doctrines to be rejected, we insist that Christadelphians should not be involved in the government in this way. This includes jury service and voting. Now, jury service and voting are issues which are a little more debated, I would say, in our community than the others, because some people believe that voting doesn't necessarily make me a servant of the state, or being on the jury doesn't necessarily make me a servant of the state. They see these as civil roles and exercising civil rights and even responsibilities. Personally, I take the more conservative stand. I would refuse jury duty, and I've always refused to exercise my political franchise to vote. But the point is that I was raised in the community where these were already standard beliefs, and they emerged partly as a result of the early Christadelphian response to the American Civil War, in which Christadelphians were very determined that they should not get involved because they believed it was not right to fight for the state, even though, of course, other Christians were arguing that this was a just cause. I think we were right to do that because there is an extremely, I would say, not so much a slippery slope, but an absolute tar pit when you start justifying war on the basis of just cause. You suddenly find that it's enormously convenient to justify the wars that you want. And I absolutely believe that Christians should not wage war. Now, having said that, the Christadelphian community at the same time was not averse lobbying government. In fact, ironically, I think we did more to lobby governments and apply political pressure on governments without voting and without taking advantage of our political franchise in our earlier years than we did in our later years. In particular, when it came to the Jewish people, we lobbied long and hard for their defense, to the British government in particular, for their defense. Not enormously successfully, it has to be said, because the British government was extremely hard-headed on that point. So I was already raised in a community in which these beliefs were fairly standard. And that strong belief in separation of church and state, absolute wall between state and church, and non-involvement of the believer in the apparatus of the state. And I think that's a very good position to hold. This also was partly, it has to be said, a result of our community being a member of the Radical Reformation and a Restorationist sect, a Restorationist Christian sect. So we believed that the Protestant Reformation hadn't gone far enough in examining all of Christianity's so-called orthodox teachings, maybe traditional teachings would be a better way of saying it. And being Restorationist, we believed that there had come a time when Christianity, as it became a state religion, had become seriously corrupted, and corrupted not just in terms of doctrine, but by its involvement in the state. Of course, the watershed moment for that is Constantine. Not that Constantine himself did very much, but rather Christians aligning themselves with Constantine reoriented Christianity dramatically. And that, as you would know, that's known in the literature as the Constantinian shift. Not so much when Constantine did things, but rather when Christian leaders and Christian communities did things to align themselves. A lot of people have a very poor understanding of this history. Constantine didn't really do very much in terms of Christianity at all. It was more Christians allying themselves and aligning themselves with Constantine to gain political advantage. And I realize, yes, there's a debate in the literature about the extent to which the Constantinian shift actually took place, but I think that that's a separate debate, and I think there's still plenty of historical evidence for it. So that was the community into which I was raised, and that was my background. Now, that is explicitly a Christian anarchist position, as you would know. Now, it was never framed to me or described or articulated or defined to me as a Christian anarchist position, and I believe very much so that one of the main reasons for this is that the early founders of our sect, who were largely English, Scottish, and early North American, did not think of themselves in terms of anarchism, because to them, anarchism meant something different. In those days, especially in the late 19th century, anarchism was, it has to be said, very much associated with revolutionary action. Tolstoy was an exception. He was a Christian anarchist who believed in, if not complete pacifism, certainly in non-violence, which Christadelphians also believe in. But anarchism at that time was not commonly associated with non-violence. It was commonly associated with violence, particularly revolutionary violence. And it has to be said that there were European anarchist groups and anarchists who literally did perform what they believed were revolutionary acts, violent acts, as part of their agenda. I mean, we famously know, of course, that World War I was triggered, at least in part, by an anarchist attack on Archduke Ferdinand. So I believe that especially our early Christian sect, the Christadelphians, found it necessary to describe themselves in terms which were very strongly differentiated ourselves from the state and made it very, very clear that we held that anti-state position whilst steering clear of identifying ourselves as anarchists, largely for branding reasons. Okay, I think if anarchism had had a different meaning and there'd been a more broad understanding and acceptance of Christian anarchism, things might have been different. But I think that that's why we didn't call ourselves Christian anarchists and why we didn't refer to our beliefs as Christian anarchism, even though we could read Tolstoy and pretty much check off everything that he wrote as, yeah, that's what we're teaching, okay? So I think that's why it was never taught to me in that way or described to me in that way. But honestly, I see that largely as a matter of branding. As you would know, our community has always emphasized very strong the kind of mutualism and mutual aid that we find not only in the New Testament, but that we find in the writings of anarcho-mutualists, such as, for example, Proudhon. And in the scholarly literature on the New Testament, you'll find the early Christian communities cited as anarcho-mutualists and sometimes as anarcho-communists, specifically for their emphasis on mutual support and aid, which has always been a strong part of the Christadelphian community because we don't want to put ourselves in the position of being vulnerable to the government. We've always needed to maintain that separation and independence from the government. So does that help answer the question?
Yeah, absolutely. And I agree with you. Even today, anarchism is not very good branding. And just to give a little bit of history for our listeners, really, as Jono mentioned, the anarchism in Europe really gave a bad name. There's two generations of anarchists. The first generation were more peaceful. They thought that they could convince people through, I guess, philosophical speeches, but peasants really didn't have time for it and did not convert to their subversive cause of kind of a peaceful anarchism. So then there was a second generation of anarchists in Russia who said that, you know, the first generation anarchists clearly didn't do anything. They didn't even remotely move the needle. And that's when they started with the violent acts. You know, they even killed the Tsar of Russia in St. Petersburg. And that brand of anarchism kind of really went wild through the news media, and to this day, when people think of anarchists, they think of violence, like here in the United States, kind of a contemporary thing. A lot of people view the Antifa, who some of them, not all of them, but some of them have referred to themselves as, say, for example, revolutionary anarchists. And whether rightly or wrongly, people have associated anarchism with violence, but that is definitely not what me and Jonathan are proposing. It's non-violence, mutual aid, charitable actions that provides a system without the need for the state, which kind of goes into what about Romans 13, right? It talks about subjecting yourself to the state. How do you synthesize that with your Christian anarchism?
Okay, good question. Now, in order to link that question back to what we were talking about before, I just want to make a point about anarchist branding. A point in particular that I have to keep on correcting when I have discussions with people, even other Christians, especially Christadelphians actually, on anarchism. I get this pushback, but how can you advocate for anarchy? Or, but anarchy is chaos? Or, why would you want anarchy? And my response to that is always, anarchism is not anarchy. These are literally two different words. Anarchism is not lack of order. It's not chaos. It means lack of rulers, lack of hierarchy. The Greek word here is not about lack of order, it's about lack of hierarchy. Having said that, of course, that leads me to Romans 13, because Romans 13 is about order and law, but still rejecting hierarchy. Okay? And now I'm going to have to explain what I mean by that. So I'm going to read Romans 13. Verses 4 to 6 for the background. This is the key part of Romans 13, and I'm reading in the New English Translation. It starts in verse 4, quote, "For it," now this is referring to the Roman state, the government, we would say, "for the government is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be in fear, for the government does not bear the sword in vain. It is God's servant to administer retribution on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection, not only because of the wrath of the authorities, but also because of your conscience. For this reason, you also pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants devoted to governing." Now, out of those four verses, people typically read these words. It is necessary to be in subjection, right? They read pretty much only that when they come to Romans 13. And they say, oh, Paul says Christians need to obey the government. And they ignore the other parts. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, this gets back to obeying law while being free to disobey leaders. And people might say, well, how are you going to obey law or maintain order while disobeying leaders? This is the point. Christians obey the laws of the state not because rulers tell us to, not because we believe that those rulers have a legitimate authority over us, but because those laws are enforcing what we understand to be good. And I believe that's what Paul says. How do I prove it? Let me read verse 5 again. "Therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection to the government." Note this. "Not only because of the wrath of the authorities, but also because of your conscience. Obey those laws." Why? Because you know they are the right thing to do anyway. See what I mean? This is not telling you to acknowledge the Roman state as your leader or as your God. On the contrary, Paul goes on to say, the authorities are God's servants, devoted to governing. So this is why he says we also pay taxes. So let's have a look. Paul assigns two roles, just two roles, to human government. One, to maintain a modicum of human public morality, I'll say, human order, to punish the wrongdoer. It is God's servant to administer retribution on the wrongdoer. Three times in these three verses, Paul says that the government is God's servant. And I'm emphasizing that because Paul emphasizes that, and it maintains the point that the government is not our authority. God is our authority, and we are God's servant, and the government is God's servant. That means the government is not over us. The government is on a flat plane along with us and the rest of God's servants. Paul describes that in very, very clear and precise terms. He emphasizes three times, it is God's servant for your good. It is God's servant to administer a retribution on the wrongdoer. God's servants devoted to governing. That's basic administration. Paul permits the government to have two legitimate interactions with the believer. One, to punish you if you break public order, the kind of rules, he says, that even your conscience tells you you should obey. Two, to collect taxes for public works. And yes, Paul was thoroughly aware of the corruption in the Roman taxation industry, but just like Jesus before him, he said that what is Caesar's should be given to Caesar. So Paul only assigns the government two roles in the life of the believer, and none of them are roles of authority. One, maintaining the kind of morality which, Paul says, your conscience tells you you should be obeying anyway. Two, taxes, because you're giving back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and it pays for public works. And yes, regardless of the corruption in the public taxation system, that money was used for public works, and Paul took advantage of that, like everybody else did. Now, how can we prove that that was Paul's position? We can prove it because whenever it came to a clash, a conflict between God as Paul's authority and the state as Paul's authority, Paul chose God. Paul explicitly broke Roman law when it contradicted the law of God, and so did the apostles. So, for example, we know that when Peter and the other apostles were brought before the Jewish authorities in Acts 4:19 and Acts 5:29, and they were prohibited from preaching Jesus because, as the Jewish rulers knew, they could get these people into a lot of trouble for preaching an unregistered and illegal religion. And when they were strictly commanded not to do that, they didn't say, oh, yeah, okay, well, I mean, you know, that's a fair point. The Roman government doesn't allow us to preach unregistered and unrecognized religions. We better not do that until we've gone through the paperwork. They didn't say that at all. They refused to recognize the authority of the Jewish rulers or the Jewish law, the Roman law that outlawed new religions. In Acts 4:19, Peter and John replied, whether it is right before God to obey you rather than God, you decide. Acts 5:29, Peter and the apostles said, we must obey God rather than people. Now, Paul explicitly took advantage of his rights under Roman civil law because he believed he had the right to exercise civil law to his advantage, especially in the furtherance of the gospel. So in Acts 22, verses 25 to 28, when Paul is about to be beaten without having first had a trial, Paul reports to the centurion, I'm a Roman citizen. Do you think it's legal to beat a Roman citizen without a trial? And the centurion, of course, is extremely concerned. And he calls to the commanding officer and says, this man's a Roman citizen. Are you aware of this? And the commanding officer is extremely concerned himself and says to Paul, well, you know, I bought my citizenship with a lot of money. And Paul says, yeah, but I was born free. And of course, the commanding officer and the centurion are horrified and immediately let him go because they know it's illegal to beat Paul as a Roman citizen. Now, why is Paul doing this? Paul is not doing this because he's acknowledging the Roman emperor as his leader. Paul is doing this because he knows it is immoral to beat someone without a trial, and he is deliberately exercising a civil right which upholds a basic law of his own conscience, something that people would acknowledge is fundamentally moral. You don't just beat people for no reason. Likewise, in Acts 25, when he's brought before the Roman governor Festus for judgment, and again, he's breaking the law, and Festus knows he's breaking the law by preaching, and Paul doesn't care. Paul is not going to apologize for preaching. And he says, I've done nothing wrong to the Jews, as you know very well, Acts 25:10. And then Acts 25:11, he says, if I am in the wrong and have done anything that deserves death, I'm not trying to escape dying. But if not one of their charges against me is true, no one can hand me over to them. I appeal to Caesar. Again, he took advantage of his Roman citizenship. So he said, look, if I have done anything guilty of death, yeah, if I've broken the law and I'm guilty of death under the law, go ahead, execute me. But otherwise, you can't. And of course, Festus couldn't maintain the charges brought against him. So Paul makes the point, of course, in Acts 28:19, that he was actually forced into appealing to Caesar because what was being done to him was unjust. So as we can see from Paul's own life, he preached the gospel even though he knew he was preaching an illegal religion, and he knew that this was an act which was illegal, for which he could be punished. And he said he was perfectly willing to be punished by the state, but he was not going to obey that law. So I think this demonstrates very clearly that for Paul, one, the state is God's servant. That means it's on the same level as the believer, because the believers are also God's servant. And Paul says that three times in those three verses in Romans 13. Two, Paul recognizes that the Roman state only has two legitimate interactions with the believer. One, to maintain a modicum of public morality. And Paul says, yeah, you should obey the laws of the state because they're the kind of laws that your own conscience tells you are the laws. And note that he's only talking about those laws that your conscience agrees with. How do we know? Because every time there was a law that his conscience disagreed with, he broke it. And secondly, he says the state's job is to collect taxes. That's it. That's the only room that Paul gives to the state. Now, people might say, yeah, but okay, do you think any modern anarchists, even especially secular anarchists, are going to take that as a legitimate argument? And I say yes. And if you ask me how, I will say to you, how many anarchists do you know who obey traffic laws? How many anarchists do you know who obey basic laws like don't murder people, don't commit wanton violence, don't kidnap people, don't violate people's rights and commit assaults? Anarchists make the point that despite their much maligned name, they are very much people of public order because they believe that the state is not necessary to maintain public order because people should be good to each other anyway. I believe anarchists actually fundamentally understand what Paul is saying. What I think people misunderstand is that being an anarchist doesn't mean you have to be lawless and you have to break all the laws, and unless you are acting illegally, then you are not being a real anarchist. Being an anarchist doesn't mean acting illegally. It means not recognizing the state as the ultimate arbiter of your conscience. And as I said, you'll struggle to find anarchists who say, oh yeah, I don't care about the law, I break all the laws, yeah, I shoplift and I drive recklessly and I break the traffic laws. They obey those laws. And if you ask them why they obey those laws, they say, what do you mean, why do I obey them? Because I know they're good for people, because I know they help establish good public order. And they would tell you, just as I'm telling you, I don't obey them because I think the state is necessary. I don't obey them because I recognize the government's authority over me. I do those things because I'm a decent human being. And I believe that is exactly the argument that Paul is making in Romans 13. And I think I can prove that very, very clearly from the fact that he specifically refers that to the conscience.
Yeah, this is something when people ask me about my anarchist belief, I point out to the fact that nearly 100% of their daily life is without the state, right? They're doing things. Yep. They already are anarchists in a sense because they go to the store, they pay for it, and they would never, even if the state didn't exist, these shop owners or people they know, they would never steal from them, right? So they're already living in this model of an anarchist society, and basically the only difference is they some of them still have this statist belief. Thank you for slicing and dicing what Romans 13 actually means. We're running out of time, so we're going to have to cut it off here. Is there any additional point before we go that you want to make, and what resources would you recommend for Christian anarchism?
Well, of course, you can refer people back to the video that I have on my own channel, but I would say a very good starting point is the book that I believe I've introduced to you before by Alexandra Christianopoulos called Christian Anarchism, A Political Commentary on the Gospel, published in 2013. That is a very, very good book, quite comprehensive. It started off as a PhD thesis, was eventually published. And it's a very accessible book with a lot of, particularly a lot of commentary specifically on biblical texts, because it's written explicitly from a Christian anarchist point of view, Alexandra himself being a Christian anarchist. And that's why I think it's particularly useful for the believer, because it's dealing with those texts, not just in a piecemeal way, but in a very holistic way, and also discusses some of the history of Christian anarchism and relates it to the broader picture of anarchism in history.
All right, thank you. Once again, I really appreciate you going over Satan and demons and now anarchy. And I think it has been a great episode, and I think our listeners will really enjoy it. And
thanks a lot,
thank you
Cam,
for coming back on the show. God bless.
Absolutely. My pleasure. God bless.